The Battle of the Somme was one of the bloodiest battles in history. It lasted for 141 days, from the 1st of July to the 18th of November, 1916. For 8 days before the offensive, 1.7 million shells were fired. On the first day alone, there were 58,000 casualties, of whom over 19,000 were killed, and 28 of those who were killed were from Cavan. This evening, we are here to acknowledge, to reflect, and to remember all those who were part of the Battle of the Somme.
Thank you very much, Sabina. As Chairman of Cavan County Council, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all here this evening to the commemoration and the official launch of the Battle of the Somme. I particularly want to welcome First Minister Arlene Foster. We are delighted. We are delighted to have you here with us, Minister Foster. Is originally from our neighbouring county of Fermanagh. I also welcome Minister Heather Humphreys, Minister of Arts, Heritage, Regional, Rural and Gaeltacht Affairs. Chief Executive Tommy Ryan, Director of Services Owen Dial and Des Maguire. To our deputies and elected representatives, Senator Joe O'Reilly, and apologies also from Dermot Wilson, Brendan Smith, Sean Smith, and Councillor Winston Bennett. I also want to welcome Bishop Fern Glenfield and Father Alton McGowan, representing Bishop Leo O'Reilly. Tefania Everett, granddaughter of General Sir Oliver Nugent, commander of the 36th Ulster Division, and also Bernita Stoney, great-granddaughter. This is another significant chapter in Cavan County Museum's piecework that extends its very innovative track record in helping us to understand conflict, war, and the path to peace. The Battle of the Somme was one of the bloodiest battles in history. Over 19,000 lost lives on the first day, and 28 of these men were from County Cavan. It is right to reflect on this event and how it impacted on all our communities. This Battle of the Somme installation sits alongside and complements other museum exhibits, including World War I Trench Experience and the 1916 Rising Exhibition. These exhibitions demonstrate the creativity of the museum in its approach to education and heritage. Through telling the story, we can enable people to have a better understanding of events from all different prospects. Through staging these scenes, we offer visitors various visual and other cues to help them see the events from the point of view of those involved. Focusing on diverse aspects of war represents our inclusive approach to history as it depicts the impact of conflict from all sides. As people visit the museum, we invite them to take a journey through history and encourage them to reflect on how this history has impacted on our families and communities. We are very proud of our museum and its excellent programming. It is a fantastic resource to have in our community and to its visitors from further afield. Our museum works with people from all age groups, all communities, all walks of life, and is constantly striving for the best at what it does. And it's thanks to Savina and the people that works here that it works so well. And I want to really acknowledge that. We are delighted that our friends from across Ireland are here with us today to help us share the reflection on these events. Since 2004, Cavan and Fermanagh County Museums have worked in a partnership to deliver a substantial cross-border school and adult programme.
We're very honoured this evening to have the granddaughter of General Sir Oliver Nugent with us, and also, as our chairman said, his great-granddaughter Benita. We've asked Tafina Everett, who's his granddaughter, to read the letter General Sir Oliver Nugent wrote to his wife on the 2nd of July 1916.
It is indeed a great honour to be here tonight, and I'm extremely grateful to have been invited and to be included in this commemoration. And I am about to read one of the many letters that my grandfather wrote to my granny Kitty, who stayed most of the war in Mount Nugent at Farranconnell. And it was to that home that he returned after the end of the war. He wrote on the 30th of June, and he wrote again on the 2nd of July. But actually, on the 1st of July, he did not write. And the letter he wrote on the 2nd of July includes information about another Cavan family, the Maxwells. And the Arthur mentioned at the beginning of this letter was his close friend, Arthur Maxwell, Lord Farnham. And he says on the 2nd of July, just a line to say that Arthur and I and my staff are all well. Yesterday was terrible. Our losses, I fear, very heavy. My dearest, the Ulster Division has been too superb for words. The whole army is talking of the incomparable gallantry shown by officers and men. There has been nothing like it since the new armies came out. They came out of the trenches, formed up as if on the barrack square, and went forward with every line dressed as if for the King's inspection, torn from end to end by shell and machine gun fire. We are the only division which succeeded in doing what it was given to do. And we did it, but at fearful cost. We are fighting today, but we have so few men left. I am hanging on till dark, when we are to be relieved by a fresh division for a fresh attack tomorrow. The Ulster Division no longer exists as a fighting force, and we shall probably go back behind the line to refit and be made up again in numbers. I do not know the full tale of losses yet, but think we have lost about 150 officers and about 6,000 men. Not all killed, and in fact I hope that a large number of them are not serious wounds. The Ulster Division has proved itself, and it has indeed borne itself like men. I cannot describe to you how I feel about them. I did not believe men were made who could do such gallant work under the conditions of modern war. The divisions took nearly 600 prisoners themselves in the first rush, and the Germans were absolutely cowed and flung themselves on their knees asking for mercy. No time for more. I am very proud, but very sad, when I think of our terrible losses. The two divisions on our right and left failed badly and left us exposed to attack from both flanks. We could do nothing but just stick it out in front of everyone else. And we are still sticking it out. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to introduce to you Brona Cleary. And Brona is the Development Officer, Programming and Promotions for the Museum Services for Mana and Oma District Council. And as our chairman said, Cavan County Museum and Fermanagh County Museum have worked together since 2004 on a fantastic project called Connecting People, Places and Heritage. And at this stage, I don't know how many children we have worked with, but I'd say at least, well, there's thousands, so I hope we have made a difference. In all the work we have done with the children and the adults in this group, the one thing we've always tried to teach them, it doesn't matter what we believe in, as long as we respect each other's beliefs. So I'm now just going to ask Brona to say a word.
Ladies and gentlemen, as you entered Cavan County Museum this evening, you were all given a card, and on the reverse of the card is the name of a Cavan soldier who died in World War I. And I would ask you just to take the card out, hold it in your hand, look at the name, and just take a moment to reflect and to remember.
Well, how do you do, young Willie McBride? Do you mind if I sit here down by your graveside and rest for a while, need the warm summer sun? I've been walking all day and I'm nearly done. See by your gravestone, you are only 19 when you joined the brave fallen in 1916. I hope you died well, and I hope you died clean. Our young Willie McBride, was it slow and obscene? Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife lowly? Did they sound the dead march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes play the files of the forest?
Now the sun shines down on the green fields of France. A warm summer's breeze makes the red poppies dance. The trenches have vanished under the plough. There's no gas, no barbed wire, there are no guns firing now. But here in this graveyard, it's still no man's land. The countless white crosses stand mute in the sand. To man's blind indifference to his fellow man, to a whole generation that was butchered and damned.
Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife lowly? Did they sound the dead march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes in the fountains of the forest?
Now, Willie McBride, I can't help wonder why. Do those who lie here know why did they die? Did they really believe when they answered the call? Did they really believe that this war would end wars? Forever this song of suffering and shame, the killing and dying were all done in vain. For young Willie McBride, it all happened again, And again, and again, and again, and again. Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife lowly? Did they sound the death march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes play the flowers of the forest?
So we'd ask you maybe to bring home that card. It's a little momentum. And remember the person you got, and their families, and the loss, and the hurt all war brought. And ladies and gentlemen, can I just at this point thank the fantastic Cavan Rugby Choir and the organist. Thank you so very much. I would now like to introduce Heather Humphreys, Minister for Arts, Heritage, Regional, Rural and Gaeltacht Affairs.
Once again, the staff and the volunteers have risen to the occasion in marking a milestone in the turbulent decade of centenaries which we have been commemorating since 2012. And it's so encouraging to see the level of commitment and the interest undertaken by the museum. You're bringing the complete story of 100 years ago to the local community here in Cavan in innovative and imaginative ways. The recent increase in visitor numbers here at the County Museum is proof that all of your hard work is paying off. As the Minister with responsibility for commemorations, I have had the pleasure of witnessing a series of inclusive commemorative exhibitions here at this museum, including the 2012 Ulster Covenant Exhibition and the Arthur Griffith Programme, as well as the 1916 Rising and GPO exhibitions this year. This new exhibition is an important contribution to the commemorations of 1916, both at home and in foreign fields. And it's a great addition to the World War I trench experience and exhibition, which of course has been opened here, as Savina said, since 2014. Just a few weeks ago, on the 1st of July, Arlene and I joined other dignitaries and leaders from across Europe in northern France for a major ceremony marking the outbreak of the Battle of the Somme. Those foreign fields contained some unbelievable stories of horror, bravery and bloodshed. And it was a privilege to be present at the events in France as President Higgins laid a wreath at the Thiepval Monument on behalf of the people of Ireland. Later in the day, I attended a very poignant service at the Ulster Tower, where the First Minister and I laid wreaths, along with Prince Charles and the French Minister for Commemorations, among others. And it was also a great pleasure to attend a performance of the Frank McGuinness iconic work of Observe the Sons of Ulster Marching Towards the Somme on the eve of the ceremonies in a beautiful theatre in Amiens. The Abbey Theatre production was supported by my department, and it was a fitting addition to Ireland's contribution to the Somme commemorative programme. The exhibition being launched today will commemorate and remember all those who fought at the Battle of the Somme through artwork, images and text. And I have to say that I'm delighted that Arlene Foster has been able to join us this evening. Your presence here, Arlene, demonstrates what this museum has been striving to achieve in this decade of centenaries, namely the recognition of the sacrifice of all those from the island of Ireland who served and suffered in the period. The participation of the members of the 36th Ulster Division on the 1st of July 1916 has been well documented and discussed. But it's so important that we do not allow ourselves to think only in hundreds of thousands, but rather to remember the individual, the son, the brother, the uncle, the father, or indeed the grandfather, as we heard about earlier. We must remember all those who perished on the fields of battle, from the so-called fortunate ones who have a resting place and the not so lucky whose names appears on a monument or a plaque. And those who returned as changed people to a changed environment and in some places a non-forgiving world. The work we see here today represents an important development in the museum's ongoing commitment to developing a shared appreciation of heritage and forging cross-border links to enhance peace. The Battle of the Somme campaign from the 1st of July to its winding down in November saw over 1 million casualties from both sides, including 3,500 dead from the island of Ireland. The total number of Irish casualties cannot be calculated with certainty, but the battle certainly claimed lives from every county in the country. On the first day of the battle alone, the British Army suffered over 58,000 casualties, of whom over 19,000 lost their lives. 28 of those killed were from County Cavan, including Private Edwin Sheriff from Coutil, aged just 19. Today's exhibition and installation further humanises individuals, which brings us all home to us about what life was like for them. And it has been so important to me that throughout 2016, all of our commemorations are inclusive, appropriate and respectful, and all of the narratives are heard. And it's been thanks to the enthusiasm and the interest of local communities and the commitment of facilities such as Cavan County Museum that this year of commemoration has been such a success. We have had an open and honest exploration of our shared history. In early September, I will travel back to those old battlefields of France, to the little village of Guimont, for a ceremony to remember the 16th Division. 1,200 of their men lost their lives in battles there in September 1916. In commemorating all of the people involved in the landmark events and movements on the island of Ireland a century ago, we have unlocked a deep interest in communities to reconnect with their culture, their heritage and their history. This exhibition will contribute greatly to that good work. And finally, I want to once again compliment Savina and her staff at the museum for the tremendous work you do in promoting peace and reconciliation. And we're so very proud of you, Savina, and the wonderful museum that you have developed here over the years. So once again, I wish you continued success and thank you very much. Gurumila Manigan.
Ladies and gentlemen, I know we'll give a good warm Cavan welcome to First Minister Arlene Foster.
Thank you very much, Savina, for your very, very warm welcome, and indeed to everyone else since I've arrived here. I'm a wee girl from Dernowald Cross, if any of you know that place, near Rosslea, so I'm not terribly far away from you at all. So it's wonderful to be here on such a beautiful evening. And it's good to be here with Heather in officially launching this very significant Battle of the Somme installation. It's a poignant addition to the museum's existing World War I trench experience. And both are a very tangible way of honouring the memory of those brave young men who sacrificed so very much to give us our freedom that we all take for granted today. And history and the passage of time have taught us so much. And I think it's very difficult for us to comprehend, to use the words of the Duke of Gloucester, as he was the president of the Somme Association at the Ulster Tower on the 1st of July, to think of the absolute hell that those young men were living through during those days. A century after the Somme, we know, for instance, that as battle approached, the weather was hot, it was humid and sticky. Thick banks of cloud hung heavy in the dawn sky along a 20-mile front north of the Somme River. And when you go to the Somme, as I had the privilege to do this year, it really is a very, very peaceful place now. And it's very difficult to comprehend the horror that was taking place there 100 years ago. But actually, when you see the geography and the topography of the battle site, you can well understand why what happened did happen. And one can only imagine how physically draining the weather conditions alone must have been on those young soldiers as they chased sleep and peace of mind in the mud-caked trenches. And the scale, the utter scale of the sacrifices is very difficult to comprehend, with Ulster casualties per head of the population being almost three times higher than that suffered by the rest of the nation. And the grim news returned to every town and every village and every county, much of a generation had been wiped out defending our freedom. And it is very fitting that we pause to reflect, to remember their sacrifice, and to take very much a sense of pride in the legacy that they left behind. As General Nugent said, he was very proud, but he was very sad. And when I was sitting looking up at that huge monument at Thiepval, a very fitting monument to all those who didn't make it home and died on the fields in France, I couldn't help think about the very personal stories, and that's why I think an installation like this is very, very worthwhile. I was there, of course, representing the people of Northern Ireland as their First Minister, but I was also thinking of my husband's great uncle, Sergeant Robert Devers, who, like so many others, went over the top on that fateful day on the 1st of July. He was injured, went home to recuperate, but insisted on going back to France, where he was fatally wounded in 1918 and didn't make it home. And when I was handed the little card, I received William James Abercrombie from Black Lion, County Cavan, and he was killed also on the 3rd of October 1918. I often think when you hear that, there is somebody who nearly made it home, but didn't quite. So for me, like so many others, it is particularly special, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing the memorabilia belonging to General Sir Oliver Nugent, commander of the 36th Ulster Division. And indeed, I really was very interested to hear his words that he wrote to his wife on the 2nd of July. So thank you very much to his granddaughter for being here and for sharing those very personal words with us. But let me finish by congratulating everyone involved in bringing this installation and indeed this special evening to fruition. I was with the Duke of Gloucester as he visited Fermanagh just this week, and when he visited Waterways Ireland, somewhere which Minister Humphreys will know very well, the Chief Executive said his visit was a bit like a family wedding. They mowed the grass, they painted little things that needed painted, and they fixed things that should have been fixed a long time ago. I hope I haven't caused that to the County Museum tonight, but I must say the place is looking absolutely fabulous. I have, of course, finally been hugely impressed by the museum's cross-border project, connecting people, places and heritage, which of course has been working in partnership with Fermanagh County Museum and the District Council. And it's good to see the former Deputy Mayor, or Deputy Chair of Fermanagh District Council, Councillor Paul Robinson, here tonight as well. And that of course resulted in the creation of the Peace Garden. So as I was sitting listening to what was going on, I glanced over and I looked at words from Jim Cleary of Virginia, and I just wanted to finish by saying those words, and they were, after war comes peace, and when peace comes, never let it go. Thank you very much.
First Minister, thank you so very much for your most beautiful words, and as we've said, it is a real honour to have you here with us this evening, and we appreciate that. And I know you mentioned Councillor Paul Robinson, and I'm very grateful to him and Councillor Winston Bennett, because they helped me in planning this evening, so thank you for that. Ladies and gentlemen, just before I ask you to move into the trenches, and in the trenches, Bishop Ferran Glenfield and Father Ulton McGoon is going to read the names of the 28 people from Cavan after a little ceremony within the trenches. But just before we do that, can I ask the First Minister and Minister Heather Humphreys to cut the tape?
I am witty, my bride, I can't help wonder why. Did those who lie here know why did they die? Did they really believe when they answered the call? Did they really believe that this war would end wars? Prayer, this suffering, the suffering and shame, the killing and dying were all done in vain. For young Willie McBride, it all happened again, and again, and again, and again, and again. Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fight slowly? Did they sound the death march as they lowered you down? Did the man play the last post and board?